We've been looking at a communication model, and it's been helpful in understanding the various pieces of our communication. And all of these pieces have to function together in order for us to send messages and receive messages without misunderstanding, without conflict. So we're going to go a little bit more deeply into the communication points now. But before I do that, I'll give one more illustration to show how powerful a frame of reference is. And maybe for some of you who aren't married yet, this will give you some help in what to do, actually what not to do after you're married. My wife and I had been married 1 year now. Our marriage survived that first year in spite of the poached eggs. And my wife is very forgiving, and to this day continues to be very forgiving, which is good for me. But after 1 year, we had an anniversary coming. And so now the question is, what shall I get my wife for our anniversary? And I thought quite a long time, and then I thought that I really came up with a very good solution, a very good answer. And so that night, she had been working. She came home from work, and we greeted, and I said, I have your anniversary gift for you, but we have to go outside to see it. So we went out, and I said, there it is, and a brand new set of snow tires for the car. It's my expensive gift to you for our first anniversary. She was stunned. And then I thought, well, she obviously was overwhelmed by how costly and how much money that I had spent. And then a little tear formed in her eye. And I thought, oh my God. I never dreamed that she would be so happy. Tears of joy. Yes, of course. See, my interpretation, just like the monkey. Peaceful, restful. Yeah. And so she went back into the house, and I followed her in thinking it's going to be a good night. I did it right. I worked hard, and sure enough, she's happy and pleased. But now she's weeping. And I'm thinking, this seems to be a bit too much of a reaction to this good gift that I've given her. And she was not weeping for joy. She was weeping because it wasn't a very sensitive gift to give for our first anniversary. How do you explain this? What would you say? And I know it's not wise. Okay, so don't tell me that I wasn't smart, that this was. But how do you explain this? What I did.
That was a male perspective that you acted from. Mm-hmm.
So tires would be something that I would enjoy.
Tires would be something like a great gift for a guy, and he would be overjoyed and overwhelmed and happy, and that's what you proceeded from when you gave that gift.
Now, does it help you at all if I say that they were brand new tires, not retreads, but brand new?
If I were a guy, yeah, I mean, I would be excited.
If you were a guy, if you were a girl?
Well, it doesn't make all that much of a difference.
They had white sidewalls on them, so it was nice and nice, you know, attractive tire.
Super for a guy, nothing for a girl.
Still nothing.
Well,
how about if they had metal studs? On the tire all the way around, so you get good grip.
Oh, metal studs would do it. Yeah, that would make me a little happier than.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I can see I'm not making any progress with you. Now.
Yeah, let me try.
Okay.
Yeah, you could say that how important we need to try for safety. So you worry for her safety, so there would be no accident, and you treasure her, and that's why you think it's important for her to have this winter tire.
Oh, you are brilliant. If only I had been so smart. Are you married?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Your wife is probably very, very happy.
You can also Ina is his wife.
Oh, so we can find out here already. He always does such good things.
I never get tires for our university. So.
But he gives you better gifts. Yeah. Okay. Now the question, it's interesting, most of the time when I share this story, the people all groan at me, you know, they're they look at me as though I'm the most stupid thing in the world, and I can see that they are saying in their minds, how could you do something so dumb? How could you be so out of touch? Well, the reality is frame of reference. But what's interesting is nobody asks me my frame of reference. Nobody, hundreds and hundreds of people have heard that story. Not one has ever asked me my frame of reference. Now, you were trying to interpret my frame of reference, and you did it quite correctly. My wife had a job as a public health nurse. She had, as a public health nurse, she had to go into some of the most dangerous parts of the city. It was winter time, and often these streets where the lower income people live are not plowed so quickly, or if they're plowed, there's lots of snow and banks of snow, and you can very easily get stuck. And those parts of the city are also dangerous after dark. So now it's getting dark. By 4 o'clock in the afternoon, my wife is still there helping people who are poor or who have new babies and they have to have help with their babies or whatever. And I'm concerned that if she gets stuck, she might not be able to get home safely. Or if she's driving on the roads a lot, they'll be slippery, and this will give her a great deal more safety when she's in these communities and when she's driving on the roads. This is the perfect gift, I say to myself. Now, I could have given her a rose, just one rose, for 100 times less money, and she would have been happier. But I didn't think of that. But you understand my frame of reference now. So now maybe it was really a good gift after all, but I should have given her a rose plus the tires, like Vitaly would do if he were giving gifts like this. When we understand people's frames of reference, we're less quick to judge. When we don't understand the other person's frame of reference, we judge them negatively, like you were doing, I think. I'm guessing you were. The way in which you smiled or laughed told me that you were thinking I was pretty foolish, and I was. I actually was very foolish because I should have done something like the flowers here. Okay, so here we are, back to frame of reference again. My intentions were good, but I wasn't thinking of my wife's frame of reference. What will my wife enjoy? What does she find pleasure in? What would she most like? What would communicate my love for her and my devotion to her? In other words, I didn't enter into her frame of reference. A little bit later, in another, probably by Thursday, we will be talking about trust. What builds trust? You can build trust from your own frame of reference, like Khrushchev did. That was an act of trust. He wanted to show friendship. That was his intention. That was his frame of reference. Here's the frame of reference right here. But he didn't ask what will build trust from the American perspective. Then he would have done something different, maybe like this: embrace, welcome, embrace. I'm glad to be here. I'm happy to see you, you know, that kind of thing. So what will build trust from the other person's frame of reference? But before we can answer that, we have to know their frame of reference. So let's go back to do that for a bit. Where do we get frame of reference? Where does that come from? How does it happen?
Usually it's our upbringing, our growing, where we grow in our culture, our experience of life, of our personal preferences, whatever food we like or don't like. So it's grow with our personality, studies, experience, mm-hmm. I mean, tears and pains and sorrows, and that's probably most that we build up into this. And
yeah, it's pretty much the accumulation of all of our experiences. All of these have shaped us in some way. What's interesting is that everybody thinks that their frame of reference is the normal frame of reference, and that everybody is pretty much like that. You have, are you familiar with Oprah Winfrey and the American television person? She grew up very poor. And people ask her, what was it like growing up poor? And she says, it wasn't any different than anybody else. I thought everybody was just like us. You see, you don't know you're poor. Very often as a child, you don't know you're rich. So everybody sort of assumes that their frame of reference is a normal frame of reference. And so consequently, when I give snow tires or when I say eggs, I just assume the other person is like me. But that is a bad assumption. That's the monkey coming out of us, assuming that we can help the fish by taking the fish out of water. Well, so the frame of reference now is the source of our assumption. This helps us because knowing our assumptions and knowing our frame of reference and knowing the other person's frame of reference is the key to understanding myself and you. The more I identify who I am, and the more I get to know you, whether you are a friend or my boss or my cousin or my spouse, the more I understand your frame of reference. And what happens when I understand your frame of reference, then this area in the center begins to grow. And the more I understand myself and you, the more this gets wider and wider. As it gets wider and wider, we have fewer and fewer misunderstandings because we're understanding ourselves and our others and the other person more and more. Muriel and I have been married now for, it's coming up on 48 years, I think, isn't it? These two circles almost overlap completely with us. So there's very little that I make assumption about her, very little that she assumes about me. It's just what you learn. It's over time. It's the understanding that you get. In the wedding in this church yesterday, they were married. They think they know almost everything about each other. They don't know hardly anything about each other. And they will discover that, like we all do. And in 6 weeks' time, they'll be saying, I didn't know that about you. And they have to have a discussion. And maybe the discussion will be good. And maybe the voices will be a little bit raised, who knows? But we have to work through those times as we get to know each other because we're expanding our frame of reference, and as we do that, we get better and better at communication. So this is important for understanding myself and my understanding of you. It's also the key to interpreting life situations. So something comes along that I don't understand. Somebody spits on your child. Now I tell you, I had all I could do to hold myself back because I wanted to be aggressive, straighten him out, show him that you don't do that to my son. Muriel had a cooler head. She was wiser. And she instructed our son that, yes, I saw that. We have to wait and understand what it means. I understood what it meant. You were insulting my son, you were insulting me, you were insulting Americans. I'll show you. See, that was my immediate response. Now, I don't think I would have acted on it, but that was what I wanted to do. Muriel says, we need to wait and to understand what was the frame of reference. So in fact, it was actually a very beautiful thing that was happening. We're going to come back with some other illustrations where we interpreted these things as bad only to find out that the person was not intending them to be bad but intending to be good. We'll come back to that. It's also now the key to responding to life situations. If I am able to understand you, I can usually say, oh, that's different. I understand why somebody would do that. That's completely reasonable. Yes, no problem. But if I don't understand, there's some research that says that we're quite quick to make judgments about others. Let me give you the research question, and then you give me the answer that you would think might be the right answer. The research that was done in America asked the question of people, how long does it take you to make a decision when you meet somebody for the first time as to whether they will be have the potential of friendship. So you meet somebody the first time, how long does it take you to say, oh, I could be friends with that person, or no, not really. Now, the way in which they measured this is that they actually had people meet each other the first time, and then they asked the person later, at what point do you think you made a decision as to whether this relationship had some potential or not? How long do you think it takes for the average, we'll say American, maybe it's true in Russia, I don't know, you judge. How long do you think it takes to make up your mind when you see somebody for the first time whether there's a potential for friendship?
My daughter, the youngest, she went to the first grade and the first time see the people who would be in her class. And right after this 1 hour meeting, she came to mom and said, Mom, I just met my best friend. So yeah. That's the idea. I just met my best friend.
Good.
I think it's short sometimes. We try to be very short, and probably in America, they're probably short. What's the first 10 minutes, 15 minutes?
10, 15 minutes, okay. Anybody want to offer another response? 30 minutes, 5 minutes, 2 minutes? Olga?
Friends. Maybe 3 or 5 days of talks, close talks.
Yeah, so we have 10 minutes, we have a few days, we have several weeks. Okay, now, I think you'll be shocked at this. Actually, in Africa, when I used to ask this question, because I knew about this research, so I was asking my African friends, how long does it take you to determine if you're going to be good friends? Oh, they said, maybe 6 months to a year, or maybe 2 years. Whoa, why so slow? See, there's my judgment, why so slow? I mean, I can figure this out, whether they're going to be good friends or not, in probably a few minutes. Why 6 months to 2 years? And they say, well, think about this, they would say. You have to find out how mature their decisions are. So that takes life, you see. How do they treat their spouse? That takes time. How good are they at fathering or mothering? That takes time. And so you can't rush these things because you have to see in the various facets of life. Now, you ready for the average American? In less than 5 seconds, the average American makes up their mind as to whether there's a potential for friendship. Less than 5 seconds. Now, you know the grocery store? Zing, zing. Zing, 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 just like that. So we scan, all right? Now, I don't know how true that is of other cultures. I think some cultures are like that. Maybe not less than 5 seconds, but maybe less than 10 seconds. But what happens now is we make our decisions based on stereotypes. Oh, I knew a Russian once. He was a good fellow. Zing, I think we could be friends. I knew another Russian once who was younger and just married or early. You see? Or this person is athletic, or this person isn't dressed very well, or this person has different skin color. Ding, ding, ding. You know, our mind is always like this scanning machine. Well, if that's the way we make our decisions, then we will never get to know each other very well, never get to understand each other. And so I think oftentimes we just move so quickly. But here's the bigger picture. The bigger picture has to do with something called, in America, it's called attribution theory. And part of that is negative attribution theory. I think we all do it. But it always gets us, I think, gets us into trouble, or at least makes things life more difficult for us. Here's how it works. When somebody does something or says something that we don't understand, we assign them a negative motive or negative intention or negative behavior. We think negatively about them. So my wife puts poached eggs on the table. Are poached eggs right or wrong?
Neutral.
Just different. But you see, I assign wrong to the eggs. Why would you do such an immoral thing to it? Now, I was trying to be a little bit humorous. Don't ever joke about your wife's food. That is never funny. That is never humorous. That is always a problem waiting to happen. So don't ever say anything about your, except that it's delicious. Yes, I love this stuff. Make it more often, please. So somebody spits on your son, and immediately I say, this is a very rude culture. They are just plain nasty. They're dirty. They're mean. Negative attribution. Okay. Eunice is a lady that works for us. Worked for us in South Africa. A Zulu lady. I might refer to her later. And Eunice uses English differently than I do. So one day when she was in the kitchen, I heard a dish fall on the floor and break. And I said, Eunice, did you break the dish? And I intentionally went up at the end of the sentence so as not to sound like I was angry or judgmental. Did you break the dish? And she says, no, Umfundis. That was a term of respect. No, Umfundis. The dish fell from my hand and it is dead. Excuse me, Eunice. She's in the other room. We don't see each other. So I said, Eunice, did you mean to say that you broke the dish? She says, no. Oh, she's got a little starch, you know, a little tension there. No. It fell from my hand and it has died, or it is dead. Whoa. You know, what's your problem, I'm thinking. Well, Muriel comes along a few minutes later, and I say to her, you know, I'm not sure we can trust Eunice as much as we thought. And Muriel says, well, why? I says, she's not willing to take responsibility. This is what happened. Here's what she said. And I saw she's not willing to be accountable for her actions. I don't know, you know, if we can really trust her very much. And maybe we ought to just watch things a little bit more carefully, et cetera, et cetera. See, those are negative attributions. So I'm suspicious of how Eunice talks, and I make the negative attribution she's not willing to take responsibility. Another negative attribution that she's not trustworthy, at least maybe she's not trustworthy. Maybe we need to watch her more closely. Another negative attribution. All of these negative things now off of that one little incident, that negative attribution. When we don't know how to interpret something, we almost always put in a negative interpretation. Because it's not like me, therefore it must be wrong or inferior. Now, I think most cultures have a tendency to do that. I think Americans maybe even more so, at least this American, that would be the case. Now, the question then arises, how do we understand this situation with Eunice? Why did she say, the dish fell from my hand and it is dead? What are you supposed to do with that? Well, we'll find out later. Let's keep going here. So now we have this frame of reference. And this frame of reference dictates how we speak, how we send our messages, the way the message is formed. It also the other person has a different frame of reference, and it dictates how they interpret our message. So everything goes through this grid, which we call frame of reference. And when the frame of reference is a relatively small area, as in the center part here, there is the possibility of a lot of misunderstanding. But when we are misunderstanding somebody, there's one important thing that we must do to correct the situation. Two words. Suspend judgment. I tend to make judgments very quickly. Eunice is irresponsible. That's all. I mean, what's there to understand? She's irresponsible. But no, she's not, actually. You'll find out. This Maasai warrior is mean. He's vicious. He's, you know, rude. But actually, as you now know, he wasn't mean. He wasn't rude. He was actually being gracious and kind. Okay. So we withhold judgment, and then we say, how am I to understand the situation? How do I get understanding? Because otherwise, we're going to have problems, right?
Have you benefited from this teaching ministry? Have you found TVS videos helpful and relevant? Please consider supporting TVS with your prayers and financial gifts. For more information, please visit www.tvseminary.com.
Now, we have this issue up here called the result in action. And this is the source of information and facts and data. Here's where we get the important information. And it connects us to the other person's frame of reference. All right, so now we get this result in action, and what does that do? That tells us what's here in the frame of reference, because these two are always acting together. One is sort of a opposite reflection of the other. It connects us to the other person's frame of reference. Now we get their perspective. What was the perspective of the Maasai warrior? I'm going to bless the child. What was my perspective from my frame of reference? This person is rude. When I get his perspective, I stop making negative judgments and I begin to see that this was actually an act of kindness, an act of blessing, and I must now see it that way. Now, when I see the resultant action and understand their frame of reference, I can go back and strengthen my message. So when my wife, when I say eggs, and now I realize that my wife's frame of reference is different, I say, would you fry the eggs, please? It strengthens the message. It makes it stronger, more precise, more clear, and it operates now with an understanding of my frame of reference and my wife's frame of reference. And then up here to the issue of expectations. This is an important one. Someone said expectations are like little gremlins. Is there a word in Russian for gremlin? Gremlin, yeah. And they sit on the backs of our shoulders and they hide in our pockets. We always have expectations. My wife had expectations when I came to the kitchen table for breakfast. I had expectations when I sat at the table. And they were very opposite expectations. And because we had very different expectations, it became an unhappy moment when it should have been a delightful moment. Same with the Maasai warrior. We always try to think the best. Now, this is the source of most of our negative attributions. So our expectations come directly from our frame of reference. And if our frame of reference does not match the other person's frame of reference, there's a good chance that our expectations will not be fulfilled. And when they are not fulfilled, we experience frustration and we end up blaming the other person, rejecting the other person, or being harsh and unkind. But it is also a unique opportunity to expand our frame of reference and move it out a little bit farther so that that will never happen again. And so if tomorrow she says, I'm going to make potatoes, how do you like your potatoes prepared? She changes her communication a little bit, and now I can be more specific. I like to bake potato, or I like mashed potatoes, or I like scalloped potatoes, or whatever, you see. And now we're expanding a little bit further out. And now we have less possibility for conflict. And I'm not as likely to hurt her feelings as I did with the eggs, which I didn't want to do, but it happened. And you feel badly about it, and you're sorry about it. But unless you have the capacity to each enlarge your frame of reference so that pretty soon the frame of reference is like this and eventually it's almost all the way across. Until that happens, we've got to be careful and say, I'm making an assumption here. That is something that's different from what I'm aware of. It's not wrong, poached eggs aren't wrong, they're neutral, they're different. I can handle differences. If it's not wrong, I shouldn't be making negative judgment about it. And so we now are able to manage our negative thinking. Every time we express something negative, it's a form of rejection towards the other person. And remember earlier I said, when we experience rejection, it's probably the most harsh of all of the negative emotions that we experience in life. And so negative, this idea of speaking negatively is a form of rejection. So now we have to suspend judgment as the one of the primary skills. Now we come over here finally to feedback. And feedback is the key to appropriate change. You can fill in the word appropriate, but it's a key to change. It's also the source of growth. So once we understand these expectations and we suspend judgment and we stop making negative attributions and we enlarge our understanding of each other's frame of reference, now we're free to change because we can change much more easily when we see things in the category of differences rather than in the category of wrong. We see things more easily in the category of differences if we're suspending judgment rather than if we've already decided that that's foolishness or that's ignorance or that's dumb or that's rude or that's unkind. And so we have to stop making those negative attributions. We have to suspend judgment until we understand. Now, usually one of two things happens as a result of this exchange up here. We either can change and grow, which is the good news. That's what we want to happen. Or we can blame. In the same situations, we can either say, I want to learn and grow and understand and change so that we won't have so many problems, so many conflicts, so many arguments. Or I can say, you know, why don't you just ask me why didn't you ask me what kind of eggs I wanted? What's the matter with you anyway? I can blame the other person, and I can keep blaming. I can find more reasons why my wife should do all of the changing. The reality is, anytime you enter a relationship, and of course the most permanent of all relationships we enter into is marriage, almost everybody believes that the other person will do most of the changing. That's kind of the hidden assumption. My husband will, I'll have him changed in no time and he'll look like me. And the wife, you know, the husband will say, well, you know, the wife's got these kinds of faults, but I'll fix those and pretty soon she'll be looking pretty good, you see. Everybody goes into relationships thinking the other person can do all of these changes. And of course, all good change will look like me, whoever the me is, you see. And when you go in with that attitude then, and the other person decides they don't really want to look like you that much, then you can start blaming and criticizing and fault finding. And then you have kind of a perpetual conflict in the home. Sometimes it's the word defensiveness also comes up here. What we do when we want to live together in peace, in love, in a caring, warm, growing relationship is that we want to suspend judgment because when we judge quickly, we usually judge negatively. We want to ask, how do I understand this behavior, these words that I'm not sure what they mean right now. I hear them. And I think I would judge them negatively, but I want to suspend judgment. And then you start to examine the other person's frame of reference, and all of a sudden you understand why they did what they did, why they said what they said, and you say, oh, well, they were actually kindly intentioned. They wanted to do the right thing. They were trying to be generous, and this was intended as a good gift, not as something that would be an insult. And now you say, okay. And then the person who gave the tires would say, you know what, that really wasn't very wise. I'm sorry, I meant well, but it wasn't wise. Please forgive me. I'll do better next time. I'll give her maybe an iron or something. No. No. together then, we move forward, understanding each other's motives and intentions, understanding each other's frames of reference, understanding how I can change, my wife understanding how she can change, so that we can better serve each other. My boss understanding how his frame of reference works, he understands mine and vice versa. Now we can work together in more peace, more harmony. And this helps us to do that. Okay, end of session.
Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion, and through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 10-11. How to give to TVS Ministry. You may give online at efta.org/givenow. In the description place, write Russia Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Or make checks out to EFCA. Write on the check memo line, Russian Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Mail to EFCA Donor Services, 901 East 78th Street, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55420-1300. Or send your gift through PayPal for tvs.gift@gmail.com.